with his sheep and decided on sheep. There's multiple reasons. First of all, the kids could help as far as there's, other than the bucks like we were talking about here, they're pretty something they can help with right away. I mean, even our 5 year old, he's pretty good sheeper. So, and they're for small scale operation. I want to do. I mean, they fit well. They're easy on the irrigation system. I mean, they're gated pipe, the corrugates, the everything. I mean, they don't trail. They don't. There's less compaction too. It's just grazing on irrigated ground like we have. So that it just fit that way. And then income wise, like with the I like wool. I always have like wool. So we wanted something with decent wool, which is even when the wool prices are down, it's still marketable. At least you can get rid of it. We have a merino. We decided on a merino rambling mix. So we've got what was our wool last year?
It was average of 19.
We had 19 micron, 60 some percent yield, like I don't know, staple length was. It's pretty good stuff. We actually had marketed it through a was it Mountain Meadow Wool?
Yes.
Mountain Meadow Wool in Buffalo. So they're pretty stoked to have that just because of just the quality and the strength, pretty strong stuff. Multiple births, I mean we do have, that's the biggest deal I guess. Money maker is not only multiple births, but having ewes with good maternal instincts, being able to take care of them. We're working on that. I mean, we started with if you started with a smaller flock, I suppose you could get a little bit better genetics. We wanted 350, 400 sheep, and so we just got from two different flocks, which is I wouldn't recommend. they share things. We got pink eye running through them first year there, and that was good times. But and then handling facilities. I mean, basically, Hurley Dock and my mentor is like, you gotta have baling wire, like a couple rolls of baling wire. So, baling wire and hog panels, and you can make something that's usable. So it's not a big output for facilities, kind of use what cattle facilities we already had. Feeding water, that's one of our water setups there with the kids on the right there. Just a tank with a hose. And I use, across our pastures, use black poly, like one, I think it's 1 inch or inch and a half of poly, and then just put garden hose fittings. And you can get a roll of that stuff for about $90. We've got however many thousand feet of it running to all the pastures, and you just plug a garden hose in and then that set up and do watering. So for our goals there, I've talked about a little bit already. We want something that's prolific. Fine wool, like I said, you can always, there's catches with the fine wool. The lambs are a little bit slower growing. I mean, the ewes are putting quite a bit of energy into making that wool, so they're slower growing, I guess. We haven't had any good luck with breed up like first year, which I've talked to quite a few producers, and that's not something they even try for. But I mean, out of 200, 180, 200 head yearlings, we had like five breed up. I mean, the merino too, they've got this long gestation. What we figured is it's like we put the bucks in
the first of the year.
And we get their first lamb the first of June. So we bump from May to June, and just kind of works better for us. Seems like the weather's settled by then. And then the maternal instincts, I mentioned that before. The some of these ewes, I don't know, we flushed them good or whatever, but these old ewes we got, they dropped 3 lambs and didn't know what to do with one. So, not something that's a keeper, you know. So, and then some of them can count. I mean, they'll have 2 lambs and they're still looking for their third one. We let quite a few of them raise triplets, and seemed to work. Make sure they're eating good. Yeah, kind of our basic production stuff. Biggest deal is the tractor. It's hard to find a decent tractor to handle feed, because we can pretty much handle anything from old round bales to the 3x3s to the 4x4s. I feed a lot of 4x4s, which are cheap for us, is the cheapest, usually the cheapest hay. So that's pretty important, you know, so we'll find a tractor. But and then grain storage, we feed pretty much half their winter rations corn. So we'll do, with our size ewes, they're about 150, 160 pounds. We do a pound of corn and then 2 to 2.25 pounds of like alfalfa hay. And that's basically feed all winter. I'd like to up the corn a little more, but we split feed it. We do feed hay in the morning. If there's no pasture left, I'll usually only feed the alfalfa every 2-3 days. Or if there's pasture, when they're on full feed, I'll feed alfalfa morning feed or corn ration in the evening or afternoon. As far as upping the corn, if I'm going to do that, I'd probably do some in the morning and some split. Any more than a pound, I'd probably split it. They've been doing really well on what we're feeding now. We use a lot of the electric net fence. We've got, I don't know, a mile or so of that stuff. And that just gives you the ability to, I don't know if you got weeds or want the yard cleaned up, or just move them wherever you want and have them secure and not running all over. So we've got some sheet fence on our place, but most of you use that electric net fence just to keep them contained. It helps with predators too. I talked about the water system there a little bit. Lambing jugs are pretty fortunate. We had some people give us quite a few jugs and just use our existing facilities to for lambing barn and stuff. Oh yeah, I feed with an ATV. Use the tractor as little as possible, I guess. So I go through about 3-4 gallons of fuel feeding every day, twice a day or whatever. About 3-4 gallons of fuel every 2 weeks. I use a hay wagon, feed the hay, and then we just got it this year. We got a cake type feeder. We've got some pictures here to follow, but it's a cake feeder that I've been feeding corn out of instead of 5 gallon buckets, and that's been pretty awesome. I had a guy ask me once, "Do you feed the?" I said, "Yeah, I just feed with buckets and a pitchfork, you know." That's how we did the first couple of years. And he goes, "Oh, like a loader bucket?" It's like, "No." "Like a skid steer bucket?" "No." "Like a paint bucket with a handle on it?" So it's been that kid, yeah. And then our storage facilities, as far as filling that feeder and stuff, it's just, we're basically just dipping buckets out of a grain bin or a truck and feeding like that. So kind of refined our feeding. Doesn't take as much time, and can have somebody else do it if we wanted to go somewhere. Handling stuff, we kind of went overboard on our. Oh, we got like a race with a bunch of fancy stuff. Pretty much looking back now, just the race with a sorting gate. I mean, you could make that out of wood or something too, but that was a pretty big expense on the front there. Portable panels, we use like a steel panel that's just pinned together, and those things, those work really well. I'll have some pictures of those too, but they work really well just to make a quick first shear. some of our stuff that's been successful, I guess, mineral supplementation is pretty big. I worked with Whit Stewart at university there, and it's been a really good resource for feed in mineral stuff. But we feed a high zinc mineral. It's ADM, I guess. But it's bioavailable, pretty good stuff. They've done well on it, and they consume it. Some of the minerals that have a hard time consuming, and I actually cut it with a little bit of salt to string them out on it. Yeah, mentors, we've had, like I was mentioning, Hurley Dockham, he's been a mentor, and then just, Whit's been a good, really good resource. And then other producers. So it's amazing when I talk to other producers and been in the sheep business and learned something every time. And there's always some little trick you learn to make things easier, more profitable. Family support there, like both her Esther's family and mine that supported us, and whether it was a loan on hay for a while or equipment or something like that. It's pretty key to us being able to even start up our business. Then secondary income with Esther, she's a legal drug dealer. She's a pharmacist. I was tell everybody, well, her income supports my sheep habits, so. So yeah, it's just super hard to get started. Maybe in a smaller scale you could start, but gotta have some other income. Our predator protection right off the bat, we found an outfit that had good dogs, and started utilizing right away. I mean, we've got plenty of coyotes and predators around, mountain lions, whatever, but that's been the biggest pain of our whole
most work, almost.
Most work, because they're always doing something. You're getting calls. Well, then we know every other producer around the area, and if their dogs are around, at least we get, the last week here, I don't know what was going on. I guess the coyotes were working overtime, but there was guard dogs all over. And, we run collars on them. GPS, like tracking collars and then shock, so we can keep pretty good track of them. They start wandering somewhere, or you wonder what they're up to. You put the collar on and see them. It's been pretty cool. You can watch them working at night when they're chasing coyotes. And, we did night pen a little bit, but with the dogs. There's no need. And then when you're grazing alfalfa, like grazing some alfalfa, every time you pull them off that alfalfa, you're pretty much asking for bloat problems. I mean, so if you night pen them and then had to take them back out there, you're pretty much asking for dead sheep. So we did that a little bit, but we figured out how good well the dogs worked, and we haven't had a problem with that. I talked to some things we learned. Yeah, the single source flock, if you're going to start up, like even if you have to start small, it's probably better just to get them all from one source and get good ones to begin with. Get something that's something like your ideal, like whatever your ideal is for wool and lamb and proliferacy or whatever. Just start with that. Just make things a lot quicker. I mean, you have a lot less time in building up a nice flock or your flock that's custom to your operation. Like I said, we had a whole bunch of pink eye from mixing two flocks. But yeah, I wouldn't want to repeat. dogs just have this thing that have bad luck with them, and I can see why. I mean, it's not like we've had good luck with every dog, but there's just a lot of different opinions on how they how to properly train them. You know, and it's different for every operation. I mean, ours are custom to our operation. We started with old dogs, but they were. It started with two old dogs and a young dog.
Yeah.
And there's different dogs, and talking about this just earlier, actually, the close guarders and the kind of medium guarders, and then some are roamers that go out and like take care of business all the time. Some of them are like, I don't know. You're basically introducing a wolf pack that works for you to your operation. So you've got all the dynamics of that pack. And I tell people that, you know, you're pretty much lying yourself out as an alpha of the pack. It's not going to work out. I mean, and the dogs too. They're tools. They're not pets. Really hard to get a lot of people to understand that. They're livestock. I mean, they're not. I give them attention if they're doing what they're supposed to, but most of the time they're not. I mean, the sheep are their life, you know. So, just learned a lot of things from other producers that have good dogs or good, well-trained dogs, and then done some stuff on our own. Those collars, the electric net fence is really good for bonding pens, like for, because you can make like a bonding pen with, you know, younger livestock, whatever. But it's if they can crawl out of it, they'll find a way out, and they'll be out running around. So with the like with our new lambs and stuff, depending on or not new lambs, like in the fall or whatever after wean, there that's a nice size or some gentle ewes or yearlings. But just a few of those mixed in with your dogs in an electric enclosure there, so none of them can get out, you know, and feed and water them there together. The dogs do need some place they can kind of get away. Like when you're feeding them, you don't want a conflict with the sheep, so they definitely need a place they can get away. I'd use it like a stock tank turned upside down, or I've got some pictures of that, I think. But nothing they can guard. That sets up problems too. Like a horse trailer or something there, if you're feeding them in, well, if the sheep decide they want to go in there with the dogs, they'll run them out. I mean, and it just causes conflict. But they basically need to share everything. And then when they are out loose with the collars, you can, once they're bonded, like our dogs now, it's like if I give them a shock on that collar, I mean, they're finding a near sheep they can find fast as they can find it. And then they'll give you this look like, oh, I've been here the whole time with you. You know, you're finding ways in between two ewes, like, yeah, you know, I wasn't on the road. So those have worked really well for us. This is something that, something I had with previous dogs, and I started using on them, and it's worked really well. A couple other producers I've talked into using those collars, keep track of things. It's just, I don't know, you can put geo fences there and it just makes your life way easier. You tell exactly what they're doing, you know, if they're actually doing their job, or if they're going over to the neighbors, if they're sitting on the neighbor's dead pile of dead horses or whatever, you can figure out what they're up to and correct them. The gestation there, I talked about that. We had high hopes for
counting our eggs before they're hatched.
With our particular sheep, like it's pretty much count on breeding it a year and a half, 2 years or whatever. And then maturity, like some of the breeds I've talked to people with, like polypay and stuff, and they can get or the real prolific breeds like the Finn and whatnot, they can do them the breed first year. And hair sheep, I've got a buddy with a bunch of hair sheep, and they he actually has to take, he doesn't castrate the bucks because that's the market he sells to, and he actually has to get them out of there a certain time or they will breed the vaccine, do the, we do a, all for the different abortion type diseases. We actually didn't do that this year. Last year we had some vaccine reaction. It was for like the campylobacter and whatever, chlamydia. But we do the CD, intertoxin type CD, and then the tetanus. Do that a few weeks before they lamb, so there's some in the colostrum, and then we'll do the lambs. About about a month or month and a half, 2 months after they're born. The coccidostat, you know, we didn't actually do that this year because it was a different scenario. They weren't. We actually weaned them out on pasture, so it's not that big a deal. We had some coccidiosis problems earlier year with, how are we feeding them? I don't, we might have creep feed them or something. So they're getting quite a bit of contamination from old ewes and stuff. And, so put a coccidostat in their mineral. But like I said, we didn't do that last year. The alfalfa for the lambs, it seems to really get them going. I mean, like creeping them with that, we've had pretty good luck with that. They will definitely want them vaccinated because we've lost some from intertoxemia. Not below necessary, they're just overeating. So that's our border collie button. That's probably a Meramer or a, Pyrenees. Pyrenees, maybe Meramer, Oshkosh mix. He's our close guarder, and we've had him since he was about 6 months old. We got him with our older dogs and the border collie that's our tractor ended up getting. We put up hay the first year because we didn't have the sheep to graze it. Now we graze all of it and don't have to worry about it. Just buy hay. So just feeding a few winters ago. There's our bucks when they first brought them home. They're a rambler. Some of them are Australian Merino, and then half of them are like a composite. Australian Merino mix. Some jerk panels. That was our first sheep there. Brought them home. Those are the first dogs we got. She had blood, how many pups last?
13.
The male area ended up getting hit on the road. We had some lambs get out on the road. I don't know if he's out there with them or eating dead deer or what, but he had no beer cars. But daughter up in there. Had some friends from India there come out and thought that was pretty cool feeding the sheep. That's our, all this, we were putting hay on that. And then I was taking buckets out of that, and that was kind of how we were feeding one last year. Doing some vaccinating. That was December, so that was before we bred. There's kind of our racing set up there for working. Some of those panels, I just wear some plywood on there. Funnel there for the race. Sharing. Getting some corn. That's our one batch of pups there. That's a little farm, isn't it?
Yeah.
We've loaned some of those dogs out to neighbors there. The trick is, if there's another flock of sheep around, is that you don't know which one they're going to pick. So last time I took him over to Marv, Missouri, he found his way to another flock and stayed there. There's some of our electric fence there. Pasture. Another little corn, some more of our pups.
Yeah, the.
Those are an Oshkosh Anatolian mix.
She had 13 puppies.
Yeah. That dog didn't make it. He'd been killing sheep for quite a while. We got him from another producer. There's just a few red flags. He didn't really like the kids. He's real, like all of our dogs that love kids, we gotta keep the kids away from them or bonding them with the sheep because they prefer the kids over the sheep for sure. But this guy is literally kids and then just had a, I don't know, you just tell when he's looking the sheep over and stuff in a predacious way. But I caught him killing lambs and that was that. This is some of our coals there. We had some really poor sheep. They're like 10, 11 year olds.
Yeah, we didn't realize their system.
Guys, we keep ours a little longer than most people. I didn't ask how much longer. Started looking at the tagging system and usually off range or fives. That was a lesson learned, I guess.
Yeah.
Get younger.
The poor naked one had wool break because she got some sort of infection.
They're pretty shabby looking bunch there, but most of them had lambs that survived. There's a part of our watering system there. You can see the polyline here. We just ran an elongated pipe in it. I just put it into it, either hydrant at the house or the plug it onto the spigot of the house and then just run feeder lines off of it. Those, and that was when we were bonding the dogs with the lambs there, so they worked pretty well. Some of our lambs. That's our bucks. Some of our fence there with the wieners, I guess, next to them.
That dog is very important.
Yeah, we didn't have the dog to start with. He's well trained and no worries with the sheep yet. Just have him bring him back. But he does a good job for us. Sheep hooks, they're kind of hard to find these days. The good ones. So found out that they don't use other as real ones. That's our little setup for. Those pups that get them right out with the sheep as soon as their eyes are open. But they need somewhere to get under, to feed them and then just to get under for protection from the ewes. Because it takes them a while to start tolerating them. And they just tolerate them because they're puppies. The older dogs, they can run right through the flock and the sheep don't even flinch. But something about puppies and the way they move the sheep takes them a while. Takes them off, get used to them, and they'll butt them around, try to protect their lambs and stuff. So they need somewhere they can get away and not get beat on. That was 12, 13.
So she had 13, she laid on one, and then there was 12, and then we ended up getting parvo, and so we lost, I think we ended up with 9 total.
We learned a lot about parvo. We were giving them sub-Q IV fluids.
We actually saved...
We saved quite a few. Actually, one older dog we got now, we saved him. He was super safe. We couldn't even approach him for months. He figured you were going to stick him with a needle, so... He's good now. He'll come right up to you and stuff, but it took him a month or so with the dog treats. And this is after they're bonded. I don't mess with them until...
For sure they're bonded
to the sheep, and then I'll start, buddying up to them a little bit. Because you got to be able to handle them, especially those collars, to take them on and off. And this collars last about 2 days. So gotta be able to handle them. And then if they're a good dog, I mean, they're getting into stuff all the time, so you're constantly doctoring them.
This particular dog too, she got to running, so we actually had to take her back.
Yeah, I took her back to the range after we got her from and brought home two more dogs.
Yeah.
So we needed. This is kind of our like set up for grazing there. Make pastures or pad on a base of a certain size. And there's water systems up at the top there, off that water line. And I mean, that's pretty heavy density there. See, I usually don't do that much, just playing around. It just takes a while to get a feel for paddock size and how many animals you got. So, sort of bone lamb feeding setup we have. There's a cooler, I don't know if you got a picture of the cooler.
We got a picture of this. This is what we originally did, and then we got a cooler system.
Yeah, you just put it in the cooler and then throw like Gatorade bottles with ice in there to keep it cool. Keep the milk cold, that way they don't gorge on it. You keep it pretty much ice cold. This is, of course, after getting them stuck on the bottle. We just gotta get them started there. But
the different ages of the lambs makes a difference, because you can see like the middle one, he's quite a bit bigger than the other two, and so we didn't have too many bums, but we watched them and made sure that they got food. But you can miss one of them if they're not getting. You can actually take and put them in jars to each individual ones and make sure the lambs are getting their fair share.
I told a guy about this, gave him some lambs, and then they all died, I think. Because they were, you know, one of them didn't because it was getting all milk, but you just gotta watch them. But we try to graft as many as we can. The base guard system of grafting is just put them in a head catch and keep them there until the milk starts going through the lamb and they'll take it.
Depends on the ewe, though. There's
some of the ewes you don't put them in the head catch, it'll kill them.
Yeah, we learned that lesson.
We lost one last year. She just kept biting until she got sideways and choked herself down. But, you can tell it's their temperament, which ones are going to work and which ones aren't. Little sheep milk in there.
This little thing is $20 on Premier One, and it.
I would say a lot of lambs, like, but
trusty tuber.
Any question if they've sucked or not, or they look a little weak, just tube them and get the colostrum in them, and I mean that'd be fine. Then. It saves a lot of. Saves a lot of time because you don't have to keep coming back and checking. You just get her done, and then they got what they needed.
Has little marks on the tube, so even I was pretty scared to use it, and then I got more comfortable.
Yeah, you actually just move it in and out of there, and it'll just hang it on the jug panel and drain it in there. It's once you get the tube in there the right depth, it's got graduations on it. It's pretty quick. I learned not to make little shelters for them. We had lost a couple lambs in there, and I wanted one hers real bad, and so she'd just maul the other one trying to get in the back corner of that little wedge thing there or something. That was when we landed in May. We could see the storms back there. I mean, it was just nonstop.
It's the year that it rains, the whole month of May.
There's the worst they've been in.
We originally did a tagging system where we had paints and painted all of them with numbers, and we were like, well, that'll give us track of which ones we can keep, and then the lambs grew up and you can tell the number. So we kind of gave up on that. It was a lot of work too.
Yeah, we just deer notched this year.
We did have a system where we put if they had twins or not, because it
just
you
put
did
a stripe on them.
Couldn't figure out if they were supposed to have two or one, so we change it up a little bit with that. With just a spray paint bottle.
We tried a little pasture lambing too, but we still have however many old ewes that are used to jugs. So if you crutched them along with jugs like that, they're not really. The pastures, it's a lot of work. Setups on our heat lamps deals. Those are like bottomless, I just put heat lamps.
head gets big enough.
Yeah, that was there in the lots of places. I put a bug in it once, I guess.
This is a little lamb carriers, but we just grab them by their feet now. There's a couple of few nifty things that we thought would be helpful, but.
That's what the hook's for.
Yeah.
There's our, yeah, like our grease setup for the shears back there.
The shears bring a plant and they just pull it up there.
I just double stack those like 4x4s or 3x4s or whatever, just double stack them and then just push the top bale off onto the trailer and then feed it like that. That way you don't have to fire the tractor up. It's a little bit of pitchfork work, but it works pretty well. And then I'll restack the, we can see some of the hay there in the back there. Just pull it next to it, flake off however much. And, snow last winter than this year. So they had a little longer. That was our bucket system there off of the, usually use the four wheeler. A lot of corn in their wool doing that too. This is a mountain lion, the dog street right there, not too far from the house. The kids came in and they're like, "Dad, there's a big old cat in the tree." I said, "Is that a short tail or a long one?" And they're like, "A long one." I said, "I better go check this out." But I didn't have a tag. I wish I would have, but so they called the game warden out to come get it. And we got these in the pasture there with the sheep, too.
I'll take you back to life.
Thankfully, we don't have these.
Yet. Yeah, you can see a race there. I got a sword and meat, but it was the end of it. We don't have it in there.
Oh, yes.
There's some of those panels we use. These things are pretty handy.
Doing some of the app tagging out in the field, and it we quickly learned that it was a lot of chasing little lambs. And
the dog worked, like, you couldn't have done it without the dog.
Yeah.
I mean, you bring him up there and hook the ewe or whatever, but it's just we had a lot of grannies, too many grannies, so it didn't mess up however many pairs, and then you'd end up jugging them anyway, and then all that. So.
So we changed it where we put if they were a female, the dot was at the top, if they were a male, the dot was at the bottom. And this one we had different colors. So this was for twins, was green. And then we put two stripes on the U to know that they had twins.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a lot simpler than doing the number.
Keep track of them. Usually if we had triplets or whatever, we'd number them at least.
Yeah. This was an outside joke. Last year it was pretty nice out, so we had.
Yeah, we did learn with the heat though, like in June, you want to put like the Catron or whatever on there. Because we dog them. Not necessarily on the nuts, but just on the tail. Just around the tail and soak it up pretty good because they'll get fly strike on that band. So.
Yeah,
that's the trip offer kit for your SU corner out and thing works awesome. I've got a battery, there's a battery on there that operates it.
Oh, wow.
I need to put a little solar panel on there, I was thinking that, and then I get it to keep that thing. Sure, I'm only running a few minutes a day. But you can set how much it feeds in piles, or you can feed it in a line too, but I like to feed it in piles, and then I can adjust how many pounds per pile. That's another hay wagon we got. I can either put a whole bale on it with a tractor like that, or just flake it off like I was doing. That thing's really loud. It calls them now, but it used to, the first time they heard it, they ran. Pretty tight spring on. I think that's about it. Is that all?
Yeah.
Questions?
Why did you pick oak? I mean, corn instead of like oats or something?
You can feed it on the ground. It's just easier to, they can pick it all up. I mean, because if I had bumps or something, you know, oats or barley, like a lot of times some of this malt barley gets too high protein and that would make pretty good feed, but you got to feed it in at least a ground bunk or something. I don't have quite the bunk space to do the whole flock, so.
Yeah, we looked at trying to get bunks, but it's more expensive, right, to get a bunch of bunks. But we have the space now because we're leasing. So we have our place and we're leasing the neighbors, and so we have lots of area to feed because they have fertilized it very well. So with no snow this year, it's kind of hard sometimes to find a clean spot to feed them. But we've got enough area with the leasing the neighbors. That
the corn too, I mean, they utilize it real well. I mean, you don't have to crack it or anything. So yeah, you don't find any pieces ever.
So how many hens have you got now?
400. Yep. So we've kept all of our ewe lambs. We just sold our wethers, and so we're just keeping the ewe lambs, and then we'll probably have to get some different bucks, different rams this next year. But that seems like we've built up a pretty good herd because we did start out with 345, and we had 68 from one flock, and the rest was from another. And but those were the first year we got rid of.
We still got like 120-some% on those chunkers, but
yeah.
This year we did 160.
Yeah. We learned a lot from having old ears.
Yeah, any problem you could possibly have, prolapses
yeah.
and all that stuff.
Yeah.
We pretty much had everything. And a lot of them, I mean, they're just so wore out, they drop the lamb in there.
Yeah, they go to
the
feed bunk.
They go to the feed bunk.
They need to take care of themselves and more things. So.
Amazing, we got a lamb out of any of those. So.
Yeah, we learned what to doctor and what not to. Most of the time, it's not worth doctoring a sheep, just the cost of antibiotics or whatever. We did this year have mastitis, though, and so we did, that was worth it.
It responded to oxytetracycline, though, because vet prescribed something that stuff was $500.
It's crazy expensive.
I don't know, it was a little tiny vial.
Yeah.
Do the tumor and have 60, 70 bucks in, and they die anyway.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I never did try it. I just did the oxytetracycline with dexamethasone and the
Bantamine.
Given Bantamine
yeah.
to bring the fever
down. Especially
it takes their temperature and their fever way up. They still lost half of their bag or whatever, but at least they survived.
Yeah.
But I don't know. Something I